I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continuously be in my mouth. My soul will make its boast in the Lord. The humble will hear it and be glad. Come on, magnify the Lord with me. Come on, make him bigger than your problem, bigger than your situation. Magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. For the Lord is great, and he is greatly to be praised. We greet you this day at our virtual worship service from the Great Open Door Missionary Baptist Church, where I'm your servant, Pastor Richard Nelson, served as the pastor here. And we're grateful to God for you tuning us in. Before I get into the message today, there's a couple of announcements that I need to make that are really important. Let me begin by saying happy Father's Day to all of the fathers that are sheltered in and are watching. Let me thank you for your continued support of shouldering the burden of this age. It is hard to be a father during this time. And so I want to appreciate you on today. As a matter of fact, my sermon will be about how hard it is to be a father in this day and age. But let me welcome you and thank you for tuning us in, and a big happy Father's Day to you all. Secondly, next week we will celebrate all of our graduates, and so this is your last opportunity. If you're a member of Great Open Door Church, please, you'll get the e-blast. Don't forget to send it in so that next week we can recognize you with all of the graduates from preschool all the way through college. We recognize all of you and for the achievements that you've made. Third of all, Thursday was my birthday. And let me thank you for all of the calls, the cards, the cash, the gifts, everything that you did to make my birthday enjoyable. I turned, I got older, let's put it that way. Some of you know that also on my birthday some years ago, I was made pastor of this, the Great Open Door Church. And so on Thursday, we celebrated 36 years as pastor of this, the Great Open Door Baptist Church, and how blessed I've been to sojourn with all of the members of this church for so long. Finally, our sermon today is taken from two gospel events, one in the 9th chapter of Matthew, the other in the 9th chapter of Mark. I want to use them as we're facing hard times today to encourage fathers that there's no problem too hard for God. We'll be back in after the praise team has sung, and I want to talk about two problems with fatherhood. God bless you.
Remember God cares.
God cares.
Matthew's Gospel, chapter 9, I want to read verse 18. It says, "While he spake these things unto them, behold, there came a certain ruler and worshipped him, saying, My daughter is even now dead, but come and lay hands upon her, and she shall live." Also, look, if you will, at Mark chapter 9, verse 21. It says, "And he asked his father, How long is it ago since this came unto him? And he said, Of a child." I want to talk this day about two problems facing fatherhood. Two problems facing fatherhood. Let's pray. Our Father and our God, we bow in humble submission to your will, your way, your word. You've been good to us. And we acknowledge that if it had not been for you on our side, we would have been swallowed up. We wouldn't have made it. And so, God, we thank you for knowing you in the power of resurrection. It's preaching time now. Your people need to hear thee and not me. Rescue me from me. Hide me behind the cross that they would hear thee. Speak to me and through me. Be reckless even without my permission. I covenant with you and this company not to take credit, glory, nor honor. But I'll tell the world you did it, and the power really does rest in you. So let the word of my mouth, yea, the very meditation of my heart, be acceptable in thy sight. For you are my God, my strength, and my redeemer. In Jesus' name we pray. Get preaching power for this hour, and we'll tell the world it was you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank God. All right. Two problems facing fatherhood. As we come to this day set aside to honor fathers, thank God, I thank God, I don't know about you, but I thank God I had a good father. When I look back over my life, may not always have been the way I felt about my dad, but the older I got, the better my father became. As a boy, I didn't understand why he would not always give me the things I wanted. I wanted a new bike. I wanted a new this. I wanted a new that. And I came to realize as I got to be a father of my own that you cannot make a boy into a man by just giving him everything he wants. You've got to make a difference by teaching him to earn some things and to live through some situations and not always have life handed to them the way they want. And it may not make sense to you, but no matter who you are, no matter what side of the tracks you live on, no matter what your social or economic bracket is, you will find yourself living in a world where fatherhood has to make the difference in those that grow up. I'm facing problems that we must face in this nation today. And as fathers, the first problem is that we have many physical successes, but not many parenting successes. What are you talking about, preacher? Well, we know how to make babies, but we have a hard time training them up. We know how to have sex, but we don't know how to have a home. We can hang in the club all night, but we can't handle a diaper change at 2 p.m. Over 60% of our children live in single-parent homes headed by women, and because men do not raise their sons for whatever reason, the end of that situation is bad. They end up in gangs, in trouble, and twisted in their understanding of family responsibility. Because our boys live without fathers in the home, they produce sons that they don't live with. And because our daughters see their mothers going to work to take care of the family, they too grow up having relations that they end up being the responsible parent, which only perpetuates our problem. We like to ride in big cars with little ideas. We make fast money and spend it without purpose. We make babies with babies and wonder why we treat each other like babies. And it's not all our fault. The system is rigged. It's set up this way to keep us struggling so that we don't have time to stop, think, and change. It was the system that would not help black families when the father was in the home. It's the system that said to our children, or when I was in school, to bring your mother up, not your dad. It's the system that said we will show the mugshot of black men on TV when they're accused of a crime, and if they do something good, we won't show any photo at all. And so black men became the problem of this modern world. We were the reason and the blame for all that is evil. So they hate us. They beat us and kill us until we hate each other. And now that we are the number one problem in America, black men are being killed daily in the streets. We are jailed at an alarming rate. We are hooked on drugs and alcohol without access to treatment. There are over 10 black women working to one black man with a job. And so it's hard for black folks to have a normal family life. But Dr. King said the arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends toward justice. Change takes a long time, but it does happen. You cannot keep killing black men and we don't rise up and force change in America. Even our babies are in the street now, crying loud, no justice, no peace. And as disappointing as our current conditions are, God is still on the throne. Yeah, you ought to know I'm a preacher. I believe God. No matter how bad it gets, God is still in control. Doesn't matter what you think. Doesn't matter how hard it seems. God has already done some things in life. And because I'm convinced that God has done some things, I can trust that God will do something else. The reason that I have hope is because I've seen God move in dark situations. I've seen God make a way out of no way. And if God did it then, he'll do it again. And so I wanted to look at these two events that take place and happen in Jesus' life as he walks on earth. Two fathers with two different problems, two problems facing fatherhood. In the scriptures that I read, it opens the door to two different events. The first is upper crust. The second is stale bread. The first, a ruling class. The second, a serving class. The first comes to Jesus. The second can only get to his disciples. The first believes. The second says, Lord, help my unbelief. The first has faith. The second is facing the facts. The first comes in worship. The second comes in need. And I point these facts out so that you have opportunity to find yourself in the sermon. All of us are one or the other. We either identify with the haves or the have-nots. Most of us are vacillating and floating between have nots and haves. One day we're up and the next day we're down. Some days we can make it and other days we fall apart. And either you're wrestling because of your daughter or it's your son. Another fact that I see in this is that your station in life will not change the problems from plaguing your life. You are or have the have-nots. Whether you got it like that or you're trying to borrow to get it like that. You believe God or you don't believe God. Can you believe God, or must you, Jesus help your unbelief? Are you making your way to Jesus, or are his disciples in your way? But it really doesn't matter, because if you are a real father, you'll deal with whatever comes up in life. If you're a real father, you'll fight your way through and make it to wherever you have to do, for your children are important to you. And maybe you need to know what happens in these two stories. Let me see if I can get you into where I am at with the thinking on this day. The Matthew's text is that a ruler of the synagogue, probably at Capernaum, called Jairus in Mark and Luke, came to Jesus and requested healing for his daughter, who Luke adds was 12 years old. She had just died. Jairus said, but he believed Jesus could restore her to life again. In the parallel gospels, in Mark's account of the story and Luke's account of the story, the father said she was dying. No, not dead, but this discrepancy is explained by the fact that while Jesus was speaking to Jairus, someone came up from the house and informed him that the daughter had died. Matthew did not mention that detail, but makes the account simple. The girl is dead. Now in the second text that I gave you, Mark's story, Mark 9, we are told about a son. But what we need to understand is that this happens in the time that Jesus is busy doing something else. Jesus has been on Transfiguration Mountain with Peter and James and John and turned inside out. They've had a wonderful experience. They've saw Moses and Elijah, and Jesus has got to get Peter straight again and tell him. Peter says, "Lord, it's just good to be here. Let's just stay here and build three tabernacles." And Jesus says, no, we can't do that. And God shows up and says, "No, Peter, shut up. This is my beloved son. Hear ye him." And Jesus says, "Let's get back down off this mountain." And so as they come down to from the mountain of Transfiguration, the disciples are surrounded by a crowd. And Jesus asks the scribes who are in the crowd, what's going on? What are you questioning them about? Why are you bothering this? And as he is asking them what's going on, verse 17 adds, one of the multitude answered. And notice, it doesn't say who it is. It just says one of the multitude, implying that this man has no social status at all, no high rank and no position of power. He's just a normal anybody. And he says, "Master, I brought my son unto thee." And your disciples couldn't do anything with him. "I brought my son." He has a dumb spirit. And wherever he takes him, he tears him, and he is foamed at and gnashing with his teeth and pining it away. And I talked to your disciples. I spoke to them that they should cast this demon out of him, and they could not. What a sad story that anybody would bring their son. And most commentaries will suggest that this was his only son. All of his life, his hope, and his future was wrapped up in this boy. And the problem is that he brings him to the followers of Jesus, and they can do nothing but make matters worse. Can I tell you, I understand why sinners stay away from church most of the time. It's not that they don't like Jesus. They don't like church folk. Church folk can make things worse. I know. I'm about to get in trouble. And don't write me. Don't email me. Don't turn me off. But I'm not talking about believers. I'm talking about folk who just show up to church. I know I got some issues. I know that I need to do better. I know that I could be a better preacher. I know that I could be more loving and kind to people. But church folk just get on my nerves. Church folks don't let you grow. We the only ones that kill our wounded. We don't try and help folks be better. We just signify. We just make it worse. And so don't mess with me. Don't be mad. Just don't be a church person. Be a Christian. But here's the real message. Here's the real revelation. One man is a ruler, and he has a dead daughter. And one man is just a nobody or anybody, has a son with a dumb spirit. And you might wonder why I would pick these two cases, but I think that they identify where we are today. I think that they're more clear for what our current events do show us as we live in America. We're living in a world of missing fathers, and those of us that show up and try to contend and confront the issues of life are surrounded by dead daughters and dumb sons. You're about to get angry, I know, but hang in there with me just a little longer. Our daughters can't hear us, and our sons won't hear us. Our girls are dead to us. They do not value our advice nor heed our warnings. Our sons are oppressed by a dumb spirit. No matter how many times we try to tell them to trust God and pray their way through their situations, stop hanging with the sly, the slick, and the wicked. Pull your pants up, turn your cap around. A dumb spirit overtakes their thinking. And they want to debate fashion and style. When it's not about fashion and style, it's common sense and safety that we're trying to make them understand. We plead with them to do to go to school, but a dumb spirit rises up and they take them deeper in sin. So it's a sad commentary on the state of fatherhood. We are in trouble. Our daughters are dead to our morals, our values, and our faith. Our sons are dumb to our history and our commitments and our Christ. But there's some good news in the text. There's good news in the scripture. Both fathers trust Christ with their children. And when a father brings their children to Christ, nothing is too hard for him to do. When Jarvis told Jesus his problem, he started out to go to Jarvis' house. And as he's on his way to deal with Jarvis's daughter, He is interrupted by a woman who has an issue of blood. And can I tell you that Jesus did nothing to help this woman? She got healed when she touched him. In faith, she reached out and just touched the hem of his garment. And can I tell you that God does not need to move heaven and earth on this day to help you? All you've got to do is just reach out and touch him. In the text, it's interesting to know that the duration of this woman with this issue of blood, this hemorrhaging, had lasted for 12 long years. Jarvis' daughter is 12 years old, this woman was unclean, and Jarvis' daughter dying would be unclean. And yet Jesus stopped and called the woman daughter. He uses an affectionate term for the woman that had no business being out in the crowd. Jesus says to her, Her faith has made her whole. The reason that she got healed is because she had faith that God could do it. Some might think that Jairus would have been upset that this woman is stopping Jesus on his way to heal his daughter. But the record shows undoubtedly that Jairus' faith had kicked in. He must have had been encouraged by this act. Well, he too had faith in Jesus. And when the multitude arrive at Jairus' house, as they follow Jesus to Jairus, the musicians are already there. The noisy crowd of professional mourners are already there. They've gathered to weep for the family, and they surround the house. They believe the child is dead. And when Jesus says the girl is merely asleep, they laugh at him, and I don't believe that Jesus did not know that the girl had died. I don't believe that he was denying that she was actually dead, but what I think is that he was simply comparing her death to a condition of sleep. And like sleep, her death was just temporary, and he would awake her from it. Can I tell somebody that? Can I get some daddy in the room right now? Some father to have faith that your daughter's death to your truth and to holiness is just her being asleep. And if you can get her to Jesus, if you can get your girl up and bring her to where Jesus is, or if you can bring Jesus to where she is, she can get woke up. Yeah. After dismissing the crowd, Jesus took her by the hand and restored her back to life, proving that he has power over death. And that's good news. But there's another text in Mark, the text, the story is told that the father finally got to Jesus. He told him his story. It's nice to see the disciples, but you need to talk to Jesus for yourself. The old song said, I once was lost in sin, but Jesus took me in, and then a little light from heaven filled my soul. He filled my heart with love, and he wrote my name above. And just a little talk with Jesus makes it right. This man finally gets to talk to Jesus. The disciples had did all they could. They probably had oiled him up and prayed him down. They probably had sprinkled him and told him to confess three times. They told him to turn around and click your heels three times. All the stuff we try and tell folk in church. Now that you can't come to church, you can't be hollering, get somebody a high five and tell them three times this and that. You got to trust what Jesus has said, not the gimmicks that we try and use. And so he tells Jesus, he said, I brought my boy to you, and your disciples couldn't do anything. And Jesus says, well, where is it? And he brought the son to Jesus, and straightway, immediately, when he brings the boy to where Jesus is, the spirit in him tore at him, and he fell to the ground and wallowed and foaming at the mouth. And Jesus looks at this boy and says, how long has he been like this? And the father says, well, since he's been a child. And oftentimes this spirit takes over him and casts him into fire and into the water to destroy him. And here's what really gets to my heart. The father looks at Jesus and said, but if you can do anything, if you can just alleviate some of the problem that we're having, if you can just do something to make this situation better. He's not even asking that he completely heal the child. He just wants some relief from what the boy is going through. If you can do anything at all, have compassion on us. Help us. Jesus says to him, do you believe? All things are possible to him that believeth. And the father looks at Jesus and says, well, I believe, but help my unbelief. Oh, I believe today. But sometimes I need the Lord to help my unbelief. I believe that he's able to do exceeding abundantly above all I ask or even think. But every now and then, I need him to help my unbelief. Every now and then, I need him to help me to believe that I don't believe. Yeah, that I look at the conditions of life. I look at how we're being mistreated in the world. And I find it hard to believe that folk that used to own us are going to respect us. I find it hard to believe that folk that get paid to kill us are going to stop killing us. But Lord, help my unbelief. And so when Jesus saw the people came running together, he rebuked that foul spirit and said unto him, "Dumb and deaf spirit, I charge you to come out of him and enter into him no more." And the spirit cried and tore at the boy, but it came out of him, and he was as one that was dead. And so Jesus says to him, "He's not dead." Look, he takes him by the hand as he did the girl and lifted him up. And he arose, proving again that Jesus has power over life. And so on this Father's Day, I've come to tell fathers everywhere that we can have a Christ that has power to solve every problem, be it deaf or life. So on this Father's Day, you see how hard it is for these two fathers to get their child the help they needed. And as a child, when we grew up, we knew how hard it was to keep us straight. And as a parent, you understand the trouble that we face now trying to raise our children in this corrupt world. But God is also a parent. He so loved you and I that he gave up his only son for you and I. And on this Father's Day 2020, think about it. Our Father in heaven gave us all that he had that we might live. For daughters who are dead and sons that are dumb, the answer is in Jesus. He is the one who came to earth. And when sin demanded our life, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. And so Jesus left heaven and rode nature's train for 40 and two generations. He got off in grew up and waxed strong in the favor of God and man. He heals the sick, yes. He raises the dead. He opens blinded eyes. He straightens withered limbs. Lame walk, blind see, and deaf hear. He went to Calvary, and outside the city wall, there he died for the sins of the world. He died, and the earth reeled and rocked. The moon ran down in blood. Stars fell from their silver socket. The earth quaked, and dead folk watched him die. He died, and they buried him in a borrowed tomb. They watched him 3 days and three nights, but on the third day morning, he got up with all power of heaven and earth in his hand, and because he died for us, and we're no longer under the penalty of our sins, and because he lives and lives ever now more to make intercession for you and I, as fathers, we can bring our children, sons and daughters, to the cross of Christ. And there, because he died for us, they'll live for him. I don't know about you, but as a father, I don't need another goofy tie. I don't need more cheap cologne. I don't need another fish on the wall that sings. All I need is for you to trust Jesus in the pardon of your sin. It's a simple act. All you have to do is invite him in. All you have to do with sincerity of heart is ask Christ the Savior, and he'll do that. And so today, before I leave you, if you don't know Jesus in the pardon of your sin, if you've never confessed hope in Christ, if you've never made God your father. Yeah. On this Father's Day, why not make him your real father? All you have to do is say, Lord Jesus, come into my life. If you've never been saved, repeat this with me. Lord Jesus, come into my life. I believe you are the Son of God. I confess with my mouth. I believe in my heart that God raised you from the dead. By this confession, I accept my own salvation, rich, full, and complete. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. If you prayed that prayer with me, I believe that God saved you not only from whatever you're going through, but all the way into eternity. And so all you need to do is just get in touch with us. Or call us. Area code 773-762-8753. Leave your name and number and a way to contact you, and we'll get back to you and walk you through the steps of discipleship that you might grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Savior. Or either email us at greatopendoor1@aol.com, and we'll do the same. But if you've made Christ Lord of your life today on this Father's Day, you got a new daddy. His name is God. Yeah. And God's not really his name. That's the title that he holds, because he's able to do it all. God bless you. Heaven smile on you. May he give you peace. Well, God bless you. Thank you for joining us today. Again, let me thank you for the kindness that you showed me over this past week on our 36th year as being pastor here at the Great Open Door Church and my umpteenth year of birth. Amen. Listen, I'm not ashamed of my age. I'm 67 years old, and everything works and nothing hurts, and God has been good to me. And so thank you for being kind to this this poor little preacher. The second thing, don't forget to send in your name. If you're a member of the Great Open Door Church and you've graduated, don't forget, we want to honor you as well on next week. Now, finally, let me thank you for the contributions that you continue to support this ministry with. Let me thank you for out of town, those of you that are not in the city of Chicago, but that continue to bless us. If this ministry, I'm sounding like one of those televangelists now. If this ministry has meant anything to you, then why not send in a contribution to help keep it on the air? Amen. God bless you. Listen, there are three ways that you can give. They're printed on the screen there for you. You can send it in the mail or drop it off at the office. It's 1302 South Sawyer, Chicago, Illinois, 60623. You can use any of the your bank cards and your debit cards. Go to our website, Great Open Door. Hit the donate button. You'll be directed to PayPal, and you can do it there. Or either just simply use your Zelle account. Go directly to Great Open Door, number one, at AOL.com, and you can contribute that way. Three ways to do it. Any way you do it, we'll be grateful for your help and your support in this thing. Until next week, God bless you. Heaven smile upon you. May give you peace. It's my prayer. God bless you. Praise him. Say, praise.